So today we're going to talk about crimes of possession in criminal law. Now, crimes of possession are largely a creature of the 20th century in American law, meaning that they become a central part of our criminal justice system over time during that time period. And the war on drugs is perhaps the most important part of that development. Now, there are many different forms of contraband that are illegal to possess. So certainly things like a nuclear weapon, but also a forged passport or social security card. And so in these cases, we're dealing with drugs and guns, right, which are the most common forms of possession crimes charged, although child pornography possession has been growing as a percentage of the federal docket for quite some time and at the states as well. But crimes by possession have often been either poorly taught or not really taught at all in criminal law courses. And I want to mention this because I think it's important to realize why, not just why they should be taught, but how they differ from our other forms of act requirements. So the reason I think they've been omitted is that they're largely viewed as just any other form of regular old conduct. In other words, they're not a crime by omission. There's nothing special about them. They don't present unique legal issues, so they're not taught separately. And if you look at a lot of possession cases, you might think that's true, right? You might actually look and say, well, yeah, the reason somebody came to possess contraband, they came to possess illegal guns or illegal drugs, was because they took an affirmative act. But that's actually not required for possession, and there are certain fact patterns that help to illustrate that. And so I think that's important, but also I think it's really important because it is such an enormous, enormous part of our criminal justice system, and the cases themselves are virtual slam dunks for the most part for the prosecution. Possession occurs at a very basic level, as we'll see, in an expansive way that defendants often don't have much to say. The cases are pled out, and this has not just the effect of extending the criminal justice system, but it also creates a void sometimes in our law, and I don't think people realize the doctrinal differences between possession and omission and, say, ordinary commission. Because the cases are getting pled out, you don't get trial rulings, you don't get appeals, and so you end up with sort of this blind spot, I think, in many criminal law courses where possession, particularly of drugs and guns, are not looked at with any depth. And so I include a quote from Sabini Nini, the case at the beginning for the Second Circuit, that articulates this distinction, right, that says possession occurs sometimes, but the government never has to prove an affirmative act, right? You know, so yes, there may have been affirmative acts. No, there may not have been. Either way, it's not part of what the government has to prove in possession, right? They do not have to allege how the illegal contraband was acquired. They just have to state that it was in possession of the defendant and prove that beyond reasonable doubt. Similarly, it's not a crime of omission because we're not saying just because they're in possession of contraband, now they have a duty to dispose of it, because it's not clear where that would fit within our list of duties and omissions. It's not statutorily defined in our possession statutes. And so it doesn't make sense to consider it in either category. And so a couple sort of maybe trivial or uncommon examples of cases that are almost never prosecuted, but you know, you can find news stories where they are. Consider somebody having marijuana grow in their yard. Marijuana does grow wildly sometimes. Sometimes it you know, migrates from a nearby illegal farm into somebody's backyard or large plots of land. It also just grows wildly. I mean, you know, it's not that illegal drugs were invented plants. They were not derived or made in some laboratory. They grew in nature. You know, sometimes, particularly here in the Midwest, there's a colloquial reference to marijuana that comes from this sort of wild growing plant. It's called like ditchweed, right? It grows in sort of ditches and areas and roads. And it's still illegal. It's still contraband to have these plants, particularly under federal law and in many states as well, right? We are seeing state decriminalization and legalization. But the possession of this plant in your yard Is enough for criminal liability. Well, you think, well, what if I didn't know that, it was growing in my ear? Well, that's a mens rea issue. We're not saying the defendant's automatically guilty if they were unaware of the possession. We will get to mens rea, but I know it's always lurking there as you're going through these act requirement cases in the back of your mind. And I want to just say, no, we're not dealing with situations where somebody doesn't know. But perhaps somebody that you're close to, a friend, an intimate partner, you're carrying a bag for them that contains contraband, right? You've assumed possession of this. So sometimes the possession occurs through a voluntary act, but not one that we're criminalizing because of that act. And so that's the bag acquisition from a friend. But then in the case of marijuana growing widely, it's just happening as a product of nature. The defendant in that instance would have done absolutely nothing to make it grow. Right? They may not even be watering their lawn. It's a weed that's invasive and growing there. And so these are examples that highlight that possession is different. It may not matter in a lot of our cases that it's different than affirmative conduct, that it's different than crimes by omission, but it's important to recognize it. Now, the two cases I include here, one of them's a pretty easy call, but it's helpful to go through and see why it's an easy call. But the other one really helps to highlight highlight the differences that possession entails, particularly when we start talking about this concept of constructive possession. So the slide, of course, is just illustrating the many drugs that are associated with criminality, but there are a lot of other things, and I've mentioned some highlights, and certainly child pornography is an important area of emerging substantive criminal law. Even though it's been around, as a concept in criminal law for a long time, the number of cases going through the system these days, particularly since the development and growth of the internet, are just, it's been skyrocketing relative to the past. So we might think of the act requirements of possession as requiring two things. And most courts phrase it this way, but I don't want to list it, as a hard and fast here are two things all courts will frame as possession. But for our purposes, I think it's safe to say these are the two requirements. Presence, meaning that it's there in some way with the defendant. It doesn't mean it's on their person. It doesn't mean it's in an item they possess. It just means it's present. It exists in this environment where the convict or where the prosecution is basing their allegations on. And then there has to be control, ownership, or dominion. And so this phrase is used a lot, or some variation of it. It's important to recognize how each of those three things, in particular the first two, are different sometimes. So first, let's pull out ownership first. Ownership is basically a property right, right? Now, you can't technically have property rights over illegal items, but we understand the intuitions of ownership, right? And it might include ownership of the container, right? So if you own the bag that the illegal contraband is, well, that can help with the analysis. If you own the car that the contraband's in, so there's ownership can be an indirect reference to how the possession occurs. Control, though, as I illustrate, the example I gave above of somebody close to you giving you a bag, right? You have control of the bag, but you don't own the contents, right? Dominion is something that actually is not that well defined in most criminal statutes in this area, but we might imagine includes aspects of either one. You may or may not own it, you may or may not have control over it, but you in some ways could exercise control. And I think this is really important in our second case, so I'll revisit it there. And so dominion is a little less well defined, and there's less case law, and I've looked at a lot of it, and a lot of them treat this phrase is one entity, control, ownership, or dominion, without breaking it down and then giving clear guidance to other courts or to future defendants about what conduct triggers each. And so I think that's important to recognize here. Okay, so these are our key aspects to define possession of contraband. Now, I mentioned the wild marijuana growing. This is a sort of example. In fact, many people do not know what a marijuana plant looks like. I got this picture from a call and a police actually arresting somebody for believing something was a marijuana plant, but in fact, it was not. So, yeah, these are issues that emerge and from time to time, but are rare. Are rare. Okay, so our first big case is United States versus Baron Rivera. Baron Rivera had been deported after being arrested for possession of an illegal firearm. He'd been previously been convicted of three different felonies in Washington. Felonies we're going to talk about a bit more this semester, but it just means any crime for which the maximum penalty is over a year when we're in federal court. He unlawfully reentered and was found by authorities. Now, it's worth having a little tangent here because this is our first immigration-related crime, and there is this growing development in criminal law, but also a growing confusion at the same time about how criminal law and immigration law mix. Particularly in debates under the Trump administration, a lot of his supporters have repeatedly made the argument that, if somebody is here without documentation, what they call an illegal immigrant or an illegal alien, that itself is a violation of law. And they usually or often will then assume that means criminal law. And that's not true, right? So you can violate immigration law and have no criminal culpability. Immigration law is a product of our civil justice system, not our criminal justice system. And this is important because sometimes the distinction is illusory, but it's one of the reasons, for example, that long-term detention of people that are set to be deported or removed from the U.S. is allowed because that's not considered to be punitive. If it were, you would have to have a trial and prosecution beforehand, or you'd have to have some sort of bail process. So the fact that it's civil is actually what allows some of the abuses we've been witnessing in the system. For long-term detention and very little protection, no access to a lawyer. These are all parts of it being designated as civil. But criminal law has, moved into parts of immigration law. So our history, for a large part was we wanted in this country a lot of immigrants. We wanted more people. We accepted them from all over the world. Now, that doesn't mean immigrants weren't discriminated against, right? There were different eras, where people from abroad and different nationalities and ethnicities faced often very severe persecution, criminalization. The Irish were, mistreated a lot. And then there's the story of how the Irish became white. They stopped being a separate ethnic group. In contrast, the Chinese population has often been viewed still as an outside class, but the level of discrimination that has been experienced by Chinese population has varied over time. So in the 19th century, we had a whole body of statutes called the Chinese Exclusion Acts that were designed just to discriminate and remove Chinese, particularly laborers from the United States, even though these laborers were being exploited for, building the railroads and other major infrastructure projects. And then they would often lose their lawful immigration status and be removed from the country. And in some cases, even people who were born here were by all rights citizens, the Chinese Exclusion Acts were designed to remove. And so these, the incidents that the historically when the sort of strong arm of the state, which sometimes includes criminal law, has been used against immigration, it's not been pretty. It's not necessarily been our finest moments as a nation. And yet we do start to see some criminalization occur more in the later half of the 20th century, but not to the degree that I think a lot of people think. So somebody who is here without documentation, which often just occurs through overstaying a visa, meaning they had lawful access and now either their work visa has expired and they don't have a job, their student visas expired, or they might have a claim for asylum that's pending. So they have an argument that under our laws, they're allowed to be here, and it just has not been resolved. Our immigration system has often been incredibly slow moving. I remember when we had a case when I was in the Eighth Circuit of somebody who had been in this nation for 20 years. They had tried to follow the process to be legally admitted, but now the government was seeking to remove them. And so this is the burden and the onus of the legal system is people often assume that the people here without proper legal status are solely at fault or they've engaged in illegal border crossings, but that's not the norm. But the role of criminal law in cases like Baron Rivera is something that's more bipartisan. In other words, the reason that immigration law is connected here is because Rivera had committed multiple serious crimes. And if these crimes not meet a certain category of sort of moral turpitude or violence, they can be the basis for deporting somebody from the United States. And at that point, after you have been deported, reentry can be criminal. And so normal entry without documentation is not a crime, but reentry after deportation is. And so it's important to recognize when the criminal law intervenes here in the immigration city and when it doesn't. So let's return to the case here. Baron Rivera, is not lawful in the United States, but he's also criminally in violation of immigration law. And there's a weapon here. In this case, it's a pistol that is found under his bed along with ammunition. His possession of that weapon is illegal because he has prior felony convictions. So we have a crime just dealing with felons in possession of a firearm. These laws have become a little more controversial after the Supreme Court's rulings in Heller and McDonald, but are still applied across the United States and are, in fact, a very frequent type of possession crime that is prosecuted. Now, he argues in his defense that the gun was there when he moved back in, when he came back to the nation. And so it's not technically his. There seems reasonable, right? The government can't prove it's ever been in his hand or been in his person. It might have been, but remember, it's the government's burden to prove that beyond a reasonable doubt. This case, he has two firearm-related charges that are both totally dependent on the ability to connect him to this gun. One is, as I mentioned, the felon in possession, but there is the separate statute, 922G5, that's illegal alien, which is the phrase the statute uses, in possession of a firearm. This is, if he can prove that, or if he can at least establish a reasonable doubt that this weapon was not in his possession, he should be not guilty of those. He still has the other charge, right, which is he is here after deportation in the United States, and that's a crime. But the other two, he's arguing against here. But as I said, this is an easy case, and I think the outcome is right here because it goes back to what our definition of or our act requirements for possession are, right? So there is presence. It's in the home. It's under his mattress. Does he have ownership? The government may not be able to show that, right? It's not clear that it was his firearm. If it had been at some point and he left it there and came back, it may have been abandoned. The ownership is more difficult here. But it's definitely in his control and dominion, right? It's under his mattress. As I mentioned before, if he didn't know it was there, that's totally different. That's a mens rea argument. But from the act requirement perspective, he's literally sleeping on top of it at night. That is within control, that is within dominion. And so it is easy to support this. And you'll notice the court uses a distinction that I alluded to earlier, actual versus constructive possession. Actual generally means on your person or in your possessions. Constructive, we associate more with this sort of control, dominion, or if it's just not an immediate there. But in truth, this is just a framework for thinking about possession problems. The statutes rarely differentiate actual and constructive possession. They just define possession, and it includes both. So if it helps you to think about actual versus constructive, you can do so. But it's not necessary, right? Because it's just that constructive possession will generally include all the actual possession as well. It's the broader category. And it means that control and dominion, these instances when it's not on your person, but it's something that you have access to and you can seize, that is sufficient to trigger our possession statute. So Baron Rivera, pretty straightforward, but provides a good basic fact pattern for how possession is not just what's in your pockets, right? It can be more than that. Our trickier case here is King. And I mean trickier here that there is this King does have a problem here, which is at one point he confesses more or less to possession. And if that was the sole basis for the Tenth Circuit's ruling, that would be understandable. But the court actually hinges its reasoning on some other facts here that I think are a little more complicated and maybe very problematic for both possession law and the racial application of criminal law. So we'll talk about that, but let's look at the basic facts. One thing that is a little confusing here, and why I include a picture of the High Point rifle in our book, is there are actually two different High Point guns here. One is a pistol, one is a rifle. In fact, there's several bits of contraband here because we include marijuana residue that's on a scale. The digital scales themselves might be paraphernalia for distribution. I mean, there's a lot of different pieces of evidence. But the one piece we want to focus on is this high point rifle, because that is the basis for two very important charges here. One is the possession of the firearm, which is illegal for Mr. King to possess. But the second is, because the firearm is there with the large quantity of marijuana, the government has also alleged this is possession of a firearm in furtherance of basically a drug distribution operation. So there are two big major charges here that are linked to King's alleged possession. So what are the facts we have here that indicate King possessed it? Well, as I mentioned, we have a confession that's not, you know, we have reasons to wonder if it was really honest and true, and in fact, King revokes it later, because he repeatedly is stating he'll assert ownership or possession of various items so long as the mother of his children, who was also there and who is the owner of the vehicle where this contraband is found, as long as she is not prosecuted. So we might see King is just motivated to make these statements to protect the mother of his children. And so here I want to again have a little moment to the side to give you a little context for why he said to me there's a racial dynamic here that we might worry about, which comes from this phrase baby mama. Baby mama or baby daddy are phrases that are often associated with African-American communities to indicate parentage of children, usually in non-married relations. Sometimes these labels are used, colloquially by people in communities, and that's perfectly fine. It's a way of offering reference to different relations. But it's also sometimes used in a discriminatory fashion when people are criticizing what they perceive to be single-parent problems within African-American communities. Perhaps to highlight, you know, an extreme version of how this loaded phrase that you might not be familiar with, or if you had been familiar with, you might not have realized was problematic, was in 2008, the Fox News cryon, so the little message on the bottom of the screen, referred to Michelle Obama as Obama's baby mama. And this is not, you know, as I said, something that is innocent. First of all, the fact that they're married makes this a little more unusual. It's usually in the context of unmarried relations. But it's racially charged language. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with the court reciting the facts to include that, because, in fact, our defendant here uses the phrase, my baby mamas don't go to jail. You know, that's what he wants, why he's asserting ownership. But the court also is using this relationship and inferring a lot of it to tie our defendant to possession of the firearm in a vehicle that he does not own, that he does not have any, there's no evidence that he has access to it, that he uses it, that he has keys to it, right? This is in the mother's vehicle. And so the question is, you know, how can we say he has dominion, control, or he doesn't seem to have ownership, at least that nothing certain here. Dominion and control is going to require access, particularly in a locked vehicle, but even an unlocked vehicle if you don't know it's unlocked. And this is a problem. And you'll notice here in the final full long paragraph of the opinion, you know, the court says, by Mr. King's own admission, he had been in an intimate relationship with Miss Washington, i.e. his baby's mama. And this is, I think, worrisome. Is reasoning, because simply because you had a prior relationship with somebody, I mean, I'm sure many of you have exes, you do not continue to have access to their vehicles. The fact that they still have children together, again, should not indicate they still have access to vehicles. But the court seems to think this is important, right? That this type of relationship can prove beyond a reasonable doubt, at least maybe combined with other facts, that he owns, he has control or dominion over the firearm. And I think that's questionable. And the fact that the court doesn't even explore what this relationship means in the specific facts, right? There's no discussion or examination of the relationship between Miss Washington and Mr. King in terms of shared resources, in terms of vehicle access, or anything like that. The court's reasoning is based on an inference of what they think a baby mama relationship and baby daddy relationship means. And I think that should give us pause, because, you know, as far as we know, they don't, the government has not offered any evidence specific to this situation. We also don't even know that much about the passage of time, you know, when they were in a relationship. If it was only, you know, the previous week or the previous day, that would be far different than if it had been over for years. And so this generalized inference, I think, is worrisome. What other evidence do we have? Well, the court also looks at the fact that our defendant has cell phone pictures. Now, the cell phone pictures here are incriminating, but not necessarily as to our high point rifle. And again, we might want more context here. So he has examples of pictures of the contraband itself, like drugs and stuff. So there's definitely not the best set of pictures for the police to find. And he has a picture of a high point rifle like the one in her car. But they don't. You notice the court doesn't say it's that actual rifle. And it's not like he's posing with it. We also don't know if he has pictures of other guns, right? You know, and it's hard to know that merely having a picture of your cell phone of the same model of gun tells us anything. And it doesn't necessarily mean control or dominion, right? You can have pictures of other people's guns. It is not something that normally is used to establish possession. Sure, there could be an inference, and it could be part of a large pile of evidence, but it's a weak connection here, I think. And so ultimately, we might be okay with the fact that the jury could have believed the original confession of King and said when he asserted that these were his items, that's they could believe that, and they believe the withdrawal of that confession and those incriminating statements was just because he's now being prosecuted. And that's fine. But the court's reasoning here and what else they include is a little more touch and go, right? I think there's reasons to worry that the court's reasoning here would create an unfair or an arbitrary rule that could be applied in cases like this, right? Using when the defendant uses a phrase like baby mama, that therefore indicates access to their property. This is, I think, an issue that's worth noting. And it shows how even subtle things that you might not be aware of or you might not be attuned to in regards to different cultures, different ethnicities, different races, different social practices can have important meaning. But the way we want to normally deal with those differences is to have testimony about them, right? About the specifics of the relationship. Or if we want to generalize, then you could have experts testify that this is a common thing in this community, in this neighborhood. And at least then we have informed judgment. But here we seem to have a panel of judges on the Tenth Circuit that are inferring a lot from something that may just be based on their subjective biases. They may be based on stereotyping. They may be based on misimpressions. They could even be wholly accurate, but it's not the type of reason that we should necessarily like to see in cases in general, but particularly in the facts here. So King shows us how a constructive possession can extend quite broadly in some instances, right? These are things that are not just on his person, but are in basically a lockbox, right? You know, they're not in a safe, but they are in a vehicle that's not right there and that we don't know if he has access to. So this is a boundary case, right? This is showing how broad possession can be. And I think it's important to realize that it's not just about what's in your pockets. We're going to talk a little bit more in class, particularly about exclusivity of possession, but I want to highlight it here, right? Could it be that everyone here was in possession of these weapons, or would it just be Miss Washington and Miss King, right? Is it enough? Can they share possession? And in fact, they can, but we just need to think that through a bit more. So there are some extra issues we'll go through in class, but this provides, again, the basic backbone of our possession law in the United States. The cases we looked at here were both involved illegal firearms, one involved drugs as well. And those drugs are our typical case and the basis for a lot of criminal prosecutions in the United States.